we have is each other. And that is the beauty of this room here. These accomplished women to your left and to your right. We're mothers, we're sisters, we're daughters. We're all trying to make that positive impact everywhere we go. So without further ado, I'm going to ask my panel to tell you what they do and their name, and we're going to take it from there.
Good afternoon, ladies. I'm Ashley Rich, your district attorney. I'm the first female district attorney in Mobile County.
I'm Liz Freeman, and I'm president of Long's Human Resource Services. Currently serve as the chair of the board for the Moderator Chamber of Commerce, so I think I'm maybe the third female in 180 years.
Hello, everyone. I am Angela Suggs. I am the president and chief executive officer of the Florida Sports Foundation. And Senior Vice President of Sports Development for Enterprise Florida.
My name is Terri Willingham-Thomas. I am a judge on the Alabama Court of Civil Appeals. My passion has always been to make sure that children are taken care of, and I still hold that passion today.
Thank you, ladies. So what you're hearing is a diverse background, but what we have in common is that it's so important for us to empower one another. And that's what we're here about, and we're hoping that you have a number of takeaways that don't just remain in this room, but we teach other women. And it begins at home. I think we can all agree on that, about, you know, encouraging one another and pouring into each other, you know, enriching each other with positive role models, men and women. So I sent all four women some questions, and I want to start with you, Angela, because you have a very deep personal story when it comes to the resiliency of your family. Share with everyone the importance of your parents and how they pour so much into you to be the woman that we see before us today.
At 48 years old, which is what I am, my parents are older, and so my reference of history is a little bit different than that of my peers. My dad was born in 1919 in Lincoln, World War II veteran. And so my understanding and my story, you know, was a little bit different. My dad's grandfather, which would be my great-grandfather, was born into slavery. And so I'm only three generations removed from a time in history. And for me to get a call from the governor of the state of Florida to come and have the opportunity to serve as the first female and first person of color in the 25-year history of the Florida Sports Foundation. It's just really, when you talk about what cannot get done, or when you talk about glass ceilings, or you talk about what is it that we're going to do, or how do you do it all, or how do you push forward, or how do you operate in a man's world? Well, of course, I grew up in a house with no excuses. Don't tell me what you can't do. So I carry that on.
What's so important is that if we take the time and talk to each other, we realize we have a lot in common. And instead of us running circles, you know, around to it seems like the world trying to get everything done ourselves, we can find out from our fellow mamas and sisters and aunts. And, you know, how did you do that? And, you know, hook me up with some information. How in the world did you make it possible? And then share that nugget with another woman. Listen to this one. So Ashley Rich, 8.5 months pregnant, you managed to really set a tone for the city of Mobile. Tell everybody what you did with baby.
So this was in 2003. This was as I was serving as an assistant district attorney in Mobile. So I was pregnant and 2 weeks from the due date of my daughter, and we had a serial rapist named Daryl Packer, who was raping women in our community. So 2 weeks shy of the due date of my daughter, I tried Daryl Packer for a rape of a woman by the name of Felicia Langford. And the interesting thing about Felicia was Daryl actually had to go to court for one of his rapes. He had raped so many women, he couldn't keep them all straight. And the day he was due to go to court, he thought he was going to court for the rape of Felicia Langford, so he killed her. But we don't have enough evidence to prosecute him for that murder. So I went ahead and prosecuted him for her rape. And so it was the first case in the state of Alabama where we successfully prosecuted a rapist with a deceased victim. Now, the interesting part was I was pregnant and I was right for closing arguments. I ran up the stairs real quick to get to the courtroom. I'm breathing heavy and I'm like, are you okay? Are you gonna make it? I did closing arguments and we were very successful and we convicted him of rape. The most wonderful part was that after the conviction, all of Felicia's family was there. They were all sitting in the first and second rows of the courtroom. And when the verdict was read, and we did what we needed to do, he was sentenced. I looked back, and they all had made handmade. I don't cry. My friend Melanie's on the front row. She knows I'm a snap. I cry all the time. But that's just part of who I am, and I'm a very emotional person. But, and they had made handmade baby gifts for my baby, who was to be born in 2 weeks. And we celebrated the birth of my child, Madeline Hurt, while we were, we had given them some closure on the death of their own child. And it was amazing that they were so supportive of me, and they were appreciative of what I'd done for them. And those gifts mean more to me than any treasures that I have in my house, because they were made with so much love.
Liz, looking at some of the questions I asked you, when I asked you who motivates you, you say my family, which is your husband and your children and your parents. And as an athlete, you think the discipline that you learned from athletics helped with you being a coachable athlete, yes, and also time management. How does that play into what you do for a living right now?
Well, first of all, time management is everything for me and for most people. Otherwise, you know, well, I feel out of control a lot of times anyway, but control is illusion anyway. But,
amen.
But no, the discipline. I mean, I was a basketball and volleyball player all throughout my childhood and through high school. And it's critical when you learn those skills, those team building skills, how to work together. You learn humility. You learn that there's a group of people that you can trust that will hold you up when you're not doing well. And the value of giving it your all when you're out there is very interesting because I look for those attributes in people that I hire for my staff. So
you can always tell a person who's doing some sort of team.
Right. I mean, usually, for HR purposes, I would not say I hire an athlete.
Right.
But there are.
Makes sense. While I have you on the microphone, tell me about Henry O'Connor and how he ties into the United Way in Southwest Alabama.
I love that Henry is a topic today. And girls and women conference. And this is also
one of our
best friends. He's actually one of the most brilliant people in a large conference. But anyway, I guess this kind of applies to sort of how my career and community started. Started in the community, aside from non-paid job. But, and I use this example a lot when I'm talking to groups that maybe have younger people in the workforce that sort of have this expectation that they come in and they just get into leadership. And none of the women here or any of you just popped up one day and someone tapped you and said, I think you'll be a great president of the junior league. It doesn't happen that way. And so this example really goes back to when I started getting involved with United Way. It's ingrained in my blood. My parents have always been strong United Way supporters. It's part of our company culture. We're huge United Way supporters. So it was just a natural extension of me. And so Henry and I were charged with changing that completely changing the allocation process for the United Way, which is historically these people get X, these people get X, X with no reporting. And so we had to move United Way to a community impact model. And that was extremely challenging. It was a really ugly work that no one wanted to do. I had a lot of people calling me very bad names. And so you know, it's just one of those things when you get in there and you do the hard work, and that's when it starts happening.
I say thank you. Judge, let's talk to you. This is very near to my heart. My husband, he's a judge and an attorney.
my family are recyclers, scrappers. We always call it the junkyard, so there's like huge piles of metal. And I was at the junkyard one day, and Daddy said, "Come here a minute, why don't you mix my high school with?" And so I went into the kitchen, and I was standing there, and Daddy put his arm around my waist, and he said, "This is my daughter," introduced me to who that was. He said, "She just ran judge for the whole state." And he looked up at me and he said, "And she's just a little girl." So we're all somebody's little girl, but we can, every one of us, do amazing things.
Amen. And we cannot hear that enough, but it begins with ourselves. And I think it's like we're in that element where we can tell everybody else something nice, but when it comes to us, it's like, "Well, I'm just a," and then fill the blank. No, ma'am, you are about it. And you're powerful, and your presence matters. And that's a big deal to hear, no matter where you are in life, because we all have our struggles. And some are more open with their struggles, and some are a little closed off, but I think forums like this, ladies, thank you for putting this on today, Shelley and Devin, it starts the conversation. But I think it's our job to continue that conversation. And peel back the curtains to what's real and what's not, because you know, if you look at our favorite magazines, Access, we look at our favorite magazines, and you see people like, "Oh my goodness, she lives this glamorous life." But let's be real, like I think about with TV, people think, "Oh my gosh, I'm on TV." I mean, I did work hard, but getting up at 2 a.m., I would always say I'd be swinging like Rocky at 1 o'clock, and it was not cute. And it's like the struggle of, yes, you want to do a good job at work, but how do I raise my family? How do I balance? How do I tell my daughter to be so strong? Yet, if you get married, how do you balance that out? And tell my son how to respect women. You know, I have to lead by example. And I think listening to your stories, we're doing that, and we're making sure to give back. Let's talk about the importance, ladies, and anyone jump in, the importance of not just having a title next to our name, but investing in the community in which we love and play in and work in. How important is that to you, and how do you go about the balance of being moms and women and wives and all that other stuff?
Sure. Well, one of our team members, Lisa Gambley, is here, and Lisa recently finished Florida State University last year, and she's not really leaving us. And so, again, she's moving on, and I've spent probably the last 6 weeks speaking with her about what's next and what she wants to do next. And one thing that the team has heard me say over and over and over again is how people do for people, and it's all about relationships. And so I did, because I already talked about that, I was one of the older people, so I was at a point where I had my dad, who was 90, and I had two-year-old. And so I was, you know, I was torn between the, you know, two generations of people, you know, and so I was a caregiver, and I was also a new mom, and a new wife, and all of that. So I took a year off. And I was probably more busier. In that year, every organization that I was a part of, I somehow found myself chairing every major fundraiser that we had, because I was off, you know, off. I had nowhere to go, or so they thought. And so what I started out doing in terms of staying at home to have more time to spend with my two-year-old, who was turning three, and with my dad, who was still driving, and I was there to police the fact that he didn't need to drive at 90. I, you know, found myself then having to find other things to do. But in that time, all the people who have then come back to me, and every opportunity that I've had, has come from relationships that I've developed through the organizations that I was working just as hard when I was not working outside of the home than I did when I was working full-time outside of home. And so when you are a part of the community I think, and I found an experience, it gives back to you. you truly get back from the community what you put into the community. And all the volunteer hours that we put in through organizations that we're a part of, when we do it and we look up and it's 11 o'clock at night or 2 o'clock in the morning and you are planning for an event, you are, you know, perhaps printing something on top of your head at work for your what you need to do. We've all done it. And so with that, you when you look back and you get it back and you see someone, it's like, where do I know you from? And it's from this event or from that organization or from just an interaction or an exchange. If you truly look back on it in terms of what it is that you are here for, your purpose, that thing that you would do for free, and you can align that with what then becomes your career, be it that it's attached to your family or it's attached to an organization that pays you perhaps, then I think that the former is better. Meaning, the question to our involvement in the community, when we can take those relationships and we can marry them to what we do for a living, the living is better.
And of course, I grew up in a culture and a family where you went to work and you gave back to the community. That's just what you did. And that's what our children need to be have wrapped around them. And so what we're all guilty of, and you know it, is overcommitting ourselves. And so that becomes very dangerous. And I had a very wise person say to me one time, and I have to say this to myself on a regular basis, when you say yes to something, you're saying no to something else, be it your children, your work, your another group that you're involved with. And that's not fair to anybody. It's not fair to you. It's not fair to others. So, I'm trying to find a way to commit to a few things that I'm truly passionate about. Because it also, when you start talking about it helping your career, I mean, it's got to be genuine. And you've got to truly have a passion for it. And people see through that. They know when you care. And they lift you up.
And I think also when they're honest with saying, I would love to assist, but I can only give this much time, instead of just immediately saying yes, and then you're never seen, and then you feel bad wherever else you are, and then you come back and you're just apologetic, and it's like you're running late somewhere. You overdo everything, you're trying to make up for the missteps, and you go, but again, we're human. And I think as women, it's like we're told to be so nice and so welcoming and make everybody feel good, but what about us? I remember the saying that my mom would always say is the better you are to you is the better you can be to other people. And that's so important because we're in a society where we women are made to feel bad if we go get a pedicure or we get our hair done or a massage. Why? Well, why is that not part of our wholeness? You know, why is that not part of boosting our own self-esteem? And I'm going to bring it back to you, Liz, because I asked the ladies, you know, what do you do for balance? What, you know, travel or cooking or... No, I like this. Liz, you gotta share it though. And tell them what you said.
Therapy.
Yes, I said I have a sweet little lady who helps clean my house because it saved my marriage. Because me and my husband do not fight about who's gonna clean the toilet and who's gonna vacuum the floors. And either there's nothing like coming home at the end of a long day and having a clean house and clean everything. And I promise you, it makes me shallow for that money that I don't have. But I'd rather have somebody clean my house and go out to dinner because it refreshes my soul.
And the power of what you both said and all the time in our heads is that right now you just helped unlock the door for somebody to say, you know what? It is okay. It is okay to get
it. It is. I mean,
balance comes in different forms, right? Okay, Ashley, since you're talking, let's talk about bucket list, you know, what's on there. This is very interesting to me because most people think bucket list, they think, okay, in another thing wrong, travel or wanting to, how can you say what I said? You said that you have a child with dyslexia and you want to see this child become a multi-millionaire investing into something or owning his own company. Why so? Why is that on your bucket list?
Okay, I'm going to cry. So I just told the whole world.
so much in his life, but he's brilliant in other ways. He's not brilliant in school, and if I told him he never had to go to school another day, he would say, I never go to school another day. And many of you out there have children who have the same types of issues. It doesn't have to be dyslexia, it could be anything. But he's brilliant. He can take apart a carburetor, he can fix a dirt bike or a four-wheeler, or his own boat that he saved money and bought by himself. And he struggles so much, and it gets in his psyche, like we were talking about with Rachel, like Rachel was talking about. And so he struggles with his self-esteem. And let me just tell you, it's really hard being a kid of the day. Everybody's done it for you. It's really hard. And so I know that he may not go to college, and that's okay. But I know someday he's going to use the skills that he has, that he has built on, to make himself, to have a great career and to do something and succeed. And it's just on my bucket list to see him where he doesn't have struggles to face every single day. And I think everybody out there who's a mother wants the exact same thing for their own kid. And I just wanted to share that.
I think that's beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. Well, and the fact that he has you as his mom, come on. I mean, that's, yeah, it's tough. I know, don't make me cry. Don't make me cry, because I have a child that, and he, I would say he learns differently. And it's important that he understands that, because there's a part of his brain that excels at things that everybody's like, how in the world? And there's some basic things that he struggles with. And you want to give him all your experience and say, take that, and go. But what they're blessed to have are mommies who are connected.
They have to find their own way.
That's right.
But we can certainly help them along the way.
That's right. That is so very important. I like this. So, Judge, you were talking about a moment in time that impacted your career. It happened when you were a receptionist in a law firm. Tell us more about this story.
I was single and trying to make it at my oldest daughter, who was 7, maybe. So the job I got was a receptionist in a law firm. And there was a female attorney who was one of the, ice-breaking female attorneys, one of the first in the state. But she would walk in, and she wouldn't look at me, but kind of at me and throw her keys at me and say, I need gas. And I don't know where the men are in the audience, but my seat where I sat, she would always have her legs. Just like this, and when she itched, she
scratched. You know, I didn't see that.
I know, and I had to see that all the time, and I always had to have her throw her keys at me. And when I would go get her car full of gas, I was like, ooh, pothole.
It also makes me a more genuine person too.
And that translates to a jury that I appear before, and they know that I'm real, and that I'm just a normal person just like anybody else. But I think you have to embrace, if you are an emotional person, you have to embrace, I kind of consider it sort of a fault, but you have to embrace those things and just be honest and really let people know, you know, who you are, no matter what the circumstances. And it will always help you well.
In like a male-dominated field, how do you know as a woman when to speak up? Because I know I have a lot of scenarios where I'm like, there's a situation, and I leave that situation, I'm like, man, I should have said something different, or I should have said this instead of being quiet. Like, how do you know when to speak up, when to voice your concerns or your opinion, and when to just sit back and observe?
Instead of hanging out the golf course, we're going to nothing wrong with approaching it. I want to get to know you better. I want to know what interests you. I want to know about your business. I want to understand your role. And if there may or may not be a connection, and when there is, if it's something that the person needs, then it can potentially turn into a successful business relationship. But you can't be afraid to ask. I mean, the worst thing that's going to happen is somebody's going to say no. So I'm kind of
bold. And I think as women, I think we overthink things. And that's not coming from me. My husband politely pointed that out to me. Yeah. He's like, this is flowery. Just give me the bullet points. But then she said, and he said, no, get to it. Get to it. And I think as we grow up, you know, like I said, we're told to be so nice and so accommodating to everyone. And it's almost like it's a bad thing to say what we want, because we may be called all types of sacred words. But it's okay to stand up for yourself. And I think that when you join clubs that are very interesting to you, you make sure to work your way around the room at different meetings, sit by a different person each time, and get to know them. And what you find is that you're not going to your crutch phrases or, you know, asking the same types of questions. You're now thinking outside the box. And then they're realizing talents that you have. You're realizing talents that they have. And let's be real, we're professionals. We have bills to pay and kids who like to eat. So, you know, we to find that balance of having fun, but understanding that business is what connects us, but it doesn't define us. I think that's very important.
One other thing with that, the thing with the golf course, you have, they're very selective, because 4 hours is a lot of time. It really is. And so if you kind of think about it, they're very intentional and strategic in terms of who they spend their time with, and that target in terms of going after the business, going after the appointment, going after whatever that solution is. They have decided that these three guys I am going to spend 4 hours with. And when we then become very exact about who we spend our time with to get what we want, and I think that will help us as well.
I have one more comment to the previous question about, I guess, being around the table, ordering for them, and they're not really monsters there. and honestly, a lot of times the people around the table have the exact same questions you do. And so I think it's so important to be humble. I think that's one of our many strengths as women, is that the majority of the time, ego does not get in the way. And so we have that ability to sit around a table full of men, and I don't have a problem saying, I'm sorry, I'm not understanding where you're coming from. Can you please rephrase that so that I can internalize it to my own personal experience, and then I can contribute. Otherwise, I'm just going to sit there quietly.
But there's probably guys at the table who didn't understand either.
Right, that's my point.
Yeah, they're like, oh, she said something. Let me ask you ladies this. What part of your life do you feel like you were comfortable with you, yourself, as a woman? Different things happen in our lives. You know, where you're like, you know what? Yes, I've gained a little extra weight, but this is the best me. Or, yeah, I may not have as many degrees as so-and-so, but I'm bringing it. At what point in your career or in your life did you feel like, I'm doing just fine. I'm proud of the woman that I see in the mirror. I am leaving behind a legacy like I asked you all about. At what part of your life did that happen, if you could share that with us?
Menopause.
Like you said, we all still struggle. And I was at a point
time where I thought that my self-worth and value was equated to the P&L of my company. And that's not everything about me, and it's not me. So, I went through a really dark time, and we say therapy. I mean, I love therapy. I send everybody to therapy. I send my kids, my husband and I go for fun, like this is just therapy. When I responded, I already cut myself down. He was like, see? And so it was the things like, I should, I need to go to this meeting, I'm choosing not to attend the meeting. Like, it's how you reframe things, and that was just tugging at me. And so now my kids are my little negative self-talk police. So they'll call me out on it. But we do that as women all the time. And I challenge you to go for the rest of the day.
I do want to mention warmth, and one of the questions I think that we were asked is, what would you tell your 20-year-old self? And my answer was not to let anyone or anything hold you back. And the reason I wanted to bring that up now is I was in a very bad marriage where it was psychological warfare, and I now can speak in front of a group of people. He had been where I couldn't speak in front of anyone. I was told I would never be anything. No one liked me, even my family didn't like me. And I started believing it. And then when I could get out from under that, I don't want anyone to ever have to suffer through that. So if you know of a woman who is being abused, please seek them out if you can't give them some help, because coming from it, I think I made it.
You made it big.
Versus conveying the message. it came from that book. And so those are the two. On the self-help piece, or the self-motivation piece, I'm a badass. And the other one on four for women.
I'm a big Indianers fan, so I keep the butterfly foot on my desk because we are so busy. Just like Rachel said this morning, I keep going back to Rachel. Rachel, are you still here? Phenomenal talk, by the way. But when you're so busy like we all are, and you're trying to balance your job, your husband, I always forget about my husband, your husband, your kids, and everything you have going on in your life, sometimes you forget the effect that you have on other people, and that's what the butterfly effect is about. And it always brings me back, it gets me back centered into, you do have a lasting effect on everybody that you come in contact with every day, and you need to make the best of that. And so that's what motivates me. It's a real short reading, so you can read it in like 10 minutes, and when I'm feeling down, I just bring it and I read the book again, over and over again.
And I also think that affirmation begins with self. I think that if you walk out the door every day hoping someone says, I like your hair, I like your dress, I like your whatever, you're already putting yourself 10 steps behind. It begins with you loving who you are. I mean, you have a story, whether you've been through abuse, whether you've been through breakups, whether you've been through divorces, or whatever it is has impacted your heart. Know that those scars tell a story. It's what you do with it, though. Do you allow it to define you, or do you dig deep and use that as your motivation to share your story with others, give more to others, and be the best you? You know, how do you do it? There's some days, and I tell my kids, some days, man, I hit every green light, like, yeah. But then there's other days, I mean, seriously, are these lights not synced? And I mean that literally and figuratively, because it's hard. It's hard trying to be the best woman, the best mom, the best person, the best everything. Some days just are not good days, and I'm okay with it, but because the good Lord woke me up this morning, so it gives me a new chance to get it right, is how I approach it. I ask the women, of course, a number of questions, but back to the question of what would you tell your 20-year-old self? Ashley said, don't finish college early. Responsibilities can wait. Enjoy college years because they are the best years of your life.
I got out of college for 3.5 years, and college was so much fun. I would just go back any day. That's like the part of my life that I would go back to because I had a blast. I was a social chairman of my sorority, so there we go. We had a good time.
Liz,
tell people, so good.
Liz said, take initiative, ask questions, always ask, what can you do? Angela said, I like this too. Don't let a degree dictate your career choice. Interesting to hear. Let's see what the judge had to say. She said, I would tell my 20-year-old self to never let anything or anyone hold you back, with an emphasis on the anyone. And if you think about how accomplished these beautiful women are up here, but to hear them, I mean, be raw with it, be real with it as to what helps them tick, what helps them move, what helps them give. And I think all of us have learned so much today. My final question that I asked about legacy, and here's the question. The legacy that you want to leave behind. Judge Terri says, my legacy I want to leave behind is being a strong woman, loyal friend, good daughter, faithful wife, loving mother, and dedicated, efficient, hardworking judge who always applied the law in a just manner. Angela says, because here's how I pose the question, finish the sentence. The legacy I want to leave behind as a woman, as a friend, as a daughter, wife, mother, and professional is, she said, honest conviction, character, and compassion. Liz says, I built people up. Let's see what Ashley said here. No, but it's good. She says, I want people to remember me as a giving person who placed service to others above herself and who did the right thing for the right reasons. And now this is a woman who has a mission statement. So that tells you about her overachieving ways. She has her own mission statement. And here's what it is, her personal mission statement. I will strive to be a good wife and mother, to continually better myself spiritually, mentally, and physically, to serve my profession honorably, to be a leader leader of others and to leave my community better off than how I found it. All of these things I learned with enthusiasm while having fun and to the glory of God.
And I don't make it every day, but that doesn't happen every day. But I have it on the desk underneath the glass. I try real hard to make that my life statement every day. But I pretty much fail a lot.
And yes, you got right back up and continues to pick some serious tail. Ladies, thank you so much for your time.